All right, so good morning, welcome to class. It's 9:03, so we'll start. Today will be the seventh lecture, and so we'll be moving on with the content of the course, and we'll talk about recurrent neural networks. So basically, the what we'll be interested in today is how to make sense of sequential data. How can you use neural networks, for example, on data which is structured as sequences, such as text, time series, and this kind of other data. And then we'll see in how that can even be generalized to arbitrary structures like graphs. So we'll have a first and main part today about recurrent neural networks. We'll see a few different models that are building on top of one another. Then I want to spend some time in telling you about some applications of recurrent neural networks. Maybe that can give you ideas for your project. And finally, we'll see how these architectures, or how this this mindset, I would say, can be generalized beyond sequences. And there, mainly, I will touch upon graph neural networks and neural computers. All right. So, when you look at the real world, there are many problems that actually require to process a signal which is not an image or which is not a fixed vector, as we've seen before, but a signal which is rather a sequence structure. And so this, for example, may happen in the case of sequence classification or regression. So tasks that may fall in this category are, for example, you take a piece of text and then you want to analyze the sentiment, whether or not the text is positive or it's negative or neutral. So this is a task called sentiment analysis. This is something, for example, we'd like to do if you want to let's say, analyze reviews. If you have a website and then you want to automatically analyze the reviews. Another task could be to, for example, do activity or action recognitions in videos. And so this is a task which is more and more done automatically, for example, in videos of sport events, like, I don't know, soccer matches, where you would like a system to look at the video and then automatically spot the different actions or the different activities during the match. Another example of sequence classification would be DNA sequence classification. So you take a piece of DNA and then you would like to analyze whether you are expected to have some genetic disease or not. Another kind of problem, another family of problem would be sequence synthesis, in which you don't want to just given a sequence predict category or scalar value, but actually you want to synthesize a whole new sequence. So this is something we'll see in much more details when we talk about generative models, but still I think it's important that you start thinking about these kind of problems. And so here you would think about systems that, for example, can produce text automatically, that can generate music, or maybe could even generate motion videos. And finally, and you do that not necessarily starting from some other input sequence, but rather you would just have a system that by itself, maybe given some random seed, would then produce a piece of text or a piece of music. And then, of course, you can combine the two of them, and that would be the most generic task of all, which is, in this case, sequence-to-sequence translation or sequence-to-sequence synthesis. And this, for example, could happen whenever you want to do speech recognition. So speech recognition, what you are given as input is, for example, some a sequence of sound, a waveform. And then what you want to do with the system is then to produce a piece of text, which would be the text representation of what is said in the waveform. So you would have two sequences, an input sequence as a waveform, and then another sequence, the output sequence, which now would be just a piece of text. Text translation, of course, would be another example of sequence-to-sequence translation. So whenever you would need a system to translate, I don't know, French to English, or English to Japanese, or Chinese to Hungarian, I don't know, that would be an instance of text translation. There are plenty of other tasks, and one another would be part of speech tagging, which is a task which is commonly done in natural language processing to identify, for example, the noun phrases, the verbs, and all these things from grammar that then you may use for some later purposes. Of course, this is not an exhaustive list. This is just to motivate the family of problems we'll be talking about and why it's important to have neural networks or models that are able to deal really at their core with data which is represented as sequences. All right, so if you want to be a bit more formal, so we'll say that we start with a set which I note as X, and this is a set of elements. For example, if we are dealing with text, the X set could be the set of all the words that exist in the language. And then I will say that S of X is the set of all sequences of elements from this set X, right? So this is, of course, a set which is infinite and which is made of all the sequences. So all the concatenations, all the sequences of any of the elements put together to form a sequence, right? And so this S of X will be formally defined as the union of the power sets of size T, from T equal to 1 to infinity. So you would have all the sequences of size 1, which are made of the elements of X. Then you would have all the sequences of size 2, which are all the pairs with a given order. This is important. You would have first element and then the second element from the set of elements X, and so on and so on. Then, given this set of sequences, we would formally define the problem of sequence classification as the problem of trying to build or to learn a function f, which would be a mapping between a sequence, right? So, which is a value from this set of sequences to the simplex of size c, right? So, if you have a classification problem with c classes, then you want to predict a vector of probability estimates for the input sequence. Then, sequence synthesis would be defined as the problem of trying to learn or build a function f which would map some value, some real value in Rd to a sequence in the set S of X. And then finally, sequence to sequence translation would be defined as trying to identify a function which would be a mapping between two sequences or two sets of sequences S of X and some other set of sequences S of Y. Right? What is also important here is that in the rest of the slides, we'll consider that the data that we are dealing with is time indexed, so meaning that the elements in the sequence, we can access them through an index which corresponds to time or to a position, to a location in the sequence, but actually that can be generalized to arbitrary sequences. But we just say that the order for us, it's something that we call time and that we can index, and usually I will denote that by the letter T. All right. So the main topic of today will be to design neural networks that are able to deal with sequences. And we'll see how we can then adapt them, not only to ingest sequences, but also then to produce other sequences. All right. So the first thing to say is that when the input is a sequence X, which is a member of this set of sequences, in this case, I will consider the set of sequences in which the elements are vectors of size p, right? And so this is generic enough actually to include also text that the sequences, even though they are vectors of numbers, right? This is how we would also do when we want to process sequences of text, because we would then, for example, transform the words into a vector representations, right? And each one of the word would have its unique vector representation in RP, for example. And then a sentence would be a composition of sequence of words, and then that would be the same as using as input, not the sequence of words directly, but the sequence of vector representations of those words, right? So when the input is a sequence X of variable length, which we'll call TX, then the historical approach which has been used in deep learning is to use a recurrent model, which will maintain a recurrent state. And this recurrent state, I will call it HT. And this itself is a vector of size Q, right? And the idea will be quite simple, would be that we'll ingest the element of the sequence Y by one. So the neural network will ingest them one by one. And then at every step, we'll update this recurrent state until it has processed, until it has ingested the whole sequence of size TX. Here also, I'm saying that this is the historical approach because we'll see next week that nowadays there are better architectures to process sequences that we call transformers. But I think it's still quite important to know about and learn about recurrent neural network because they are still used in many places. All right, so formally, what we'll do is that we'll for every element, so for t equal to 1 up to tx, then the id will be, as I just said, will be to compute some recurrent state that we call ht, and the computation of this recurrent state will be defined through some function phi, which takes as input two values, the element value at position t, so xt, and the previous or the current value of the recurrent state that we call in this case ht minus 1. Right? So given the current state, given the next value or so xt in the sequence, you feed them both to this phi function, and then that produces as output a new recurrent state value ht. And of course, this function phi depends on some parameters that we again generically define as theta. And of course, you can guess that this function phi will be defined itself as a neural network. Now, given this the computation of this recurrent state, predictions can be computed at any step t from this state through the use of some other function, which in this case corresponds to var phi, which takes as input the current value of the state, ht, depends on some parameters theta, and then produce as output some value. So for example, yt could be a vector of probability estimates in the case of classification, right? So this is very formal. If we were to write or to draw the graph of computation that would be involved, this we would have the following picture. So let's say that we have some sequence and of some size, and the first element would be xlab, right? Then what would happen is that we would apply the function phi to this element xi, and also to the previous value of the current state. So at the very beginning, that means we would have initialized the recurrent state of this function, of this recurrent neural network, to some value, right? And by default, for example, we could say that the initial h0 value of the recurrent state is, for example, equal to 0, right? So now given these two inputs, h0, x1, right? And of course, the parameters of the function phi, then we would produce as output a new value of the recurrent state, which corresponds now to h1. And then the idea is quite simple, is that we would repeat this for the whole sequence. So then at the next step, for the next element in the sequence, x2, we would reuse the same function phi, right? But now this same function would take as input not h0 and not h1, but would take as input the previous, or actually the current recurrent state, h1, and the next element in the sequence, which would be x2. And that would produce then again a new recurrent state value, h2. And then we would proceed like this until the end of the sequence, so until the element xt in the sequence, and finally we would have produced a final recurrent state value h3. So that means now, even though we may have sequences of variable length, right? So for example, we may have a first sentence which contains 10 words, but then the next would contain 15 words, I don't know. The same network could be used to process them both, right? And because what is important here is that we are reusing the same phi function and the same the same model parameter theta at every step, right? So this can be generalized, this can be applied to any sequence regardless of their size, right? Then if what we want, for example, is to classify these sentences, right? Then what we could do is to use the final recurrent state value and then use it as input to some other function, var phi, then to produce the final output of the system of the recurrent neural network. In this case, it would be yt. Right? So here, what is important is that, also for you to understand, is that the blue boxes that I'm representing here, the phi and the var phi functions, they can be arbitrarily complicated, right? So that means they can be neural networks themselves of the kind we've seen before. So this could be, for example, small multilayer perceptrons, but they could be as well very complicated convolutional neural networks if you want it, right? That will not change how the recurrent neural network is itself defined. Okay, so this could be used to do sequence classification. But actually, the same architecture could be easily adapted to do sequence-to-sequence translation. For example, if instead of only predicting a y value for the final recurrent state, what we would do instead is to predict the value at every value of the recurrent state. In this case, we would produce another sequence of the same size as the input sequence. So we'd have an output sequence y, which is as long, which has as many elements, so t, as input sequence x. And the way we would do that, for example, would be to just reuse the same function var phi over and over, but what would change at every step is the recurrent state value that we feed as input. And therefore, the output that we would then obtain would be different. All right, so one important thing is that, okay, if you were to implement this, then you may be wondering how will you apply automatic differentiation on this graph, given the fact that the size of the graph will change from one sequence to the next, right? If I were, for example, if I add only two elements in the sequence, then the graph of computation would be stopped in the first part on the left of the figure, but if, on the other hand, the sequence that I was using as input as I don't know, a size of 1,000, then the graph of computation would be very large, right? Well, actually, this is not too important. This will not be a problem, because even though the number of steps t depend on the input data x, this would still result in a standard graph of computation, right? And therefore, for this reason, automatic differentiation, as we have seen in lecture 3, could still deal with it as usual, right? And so what you have to picture in your mind is that it's as if we, so for example, if you apply this piece of these equations, The way you would implement them would be, for example, in a program, would be to write a for loop that goes from 1 to t, and then at every iteration, would compute this value. And then finally, when you exit the loop, you would, for example, compute the value of yt. Right? And so the number of iterations that you would do, then of course, would depend on the size of the input sequence. And as I just said, from one sequence to the next, the size may change. But this is not a problem, because you just consider the graph of computation that would be built, right? It's as if you had unrolled, it's as if you had explicitly, instead of having a for loop, it's as if you had yourself written a long sequence of these updates, right? And then finally computed the output value, right? And in this form, in this unrolled graph of computation, well, you obtain just a regular graph of computation, and you can run automatic differentiation through it, right? So the framework that you will use, for example, PyTorch, will do that, of course, automatically for you. Given the piece of Python code that you that is executed, the graph of computation would be built on the fly, right? And then automatic differentiation would be run on this graph of computation. And so in the case of graph neural net, of recurrent neural network, the fact of applying reverse mode automatic differentiation on the unrolled graph of computation is usually referred to as backpropagation through time. It's as if you are backpropagating through time in reverse. Right? So from t, then to back to t minus 1, t minus 2, up to t equal to 1. And so if you do that, if you run automatic differentiation, this is the kind of backward path that we obtain in red, right? And you see that we would have to compute the Jacobian of the output with respect, for example, to the model parameters, right? And this is something we could do as usual by just going backward over all the paths connecting some outputs to the model parameters. So, for example, if I look at yt, then there would be this path that corresponds to the computation of the recurrent state, and then backwards through time. So you then here backpropagate through time up until the theta, the model parameters theta. But as you actually reuse the same model parameters at every time step, then you see that you could also use this path. So you just backpropagate one step backward. And since this the application here at this step of the phi function depends on the model parameters, then that means there is an effect of model parameters already at this step of the computation, but also, of course, in all the previous ones. So this is why you see that there are actually many paths that you need to consider when you compute the Jacobians in this case. Right? If you remember the rule that we are using in backpropagation in reverse mode automatic differentiation, we have to loop, if I remember correctly, over the parents. In this case, you would have every time you would have in this case two of them, you would have directly theta, but also the previous value of the recurrent state, which itself depends on the model parameters. And you do that recursively until you reach the beginning of the sequence. All right. So do you have questions about that before we move on with some specific architectures? So this is an important concept. You should really make sure you understand what is happening when you run backpropagation, when you run automatic differentiation on a recurrent neural network, even though the size of the sequences may not be the same for all input elements or for all input sequences. All right, so now we'll see a few implementations, so basically a few ways to define these phi and var phi functions. So the simplest choice you could do would be to say that phi and var phi correspond to primitive neuron units, such as the ones we have used when we define multilayer perceptrons. So, and that would amount basically to just have phi and var phi being defined as logistic regression units, right? And so if you remember, that means you would say, for example, that the recurrent state is computed as, for example, the sigmoid activation of some linear combination of the inputs, right? And so in this case, we would have two inputs. We would have xt and ht minus one. So the next element in the sequence, xt, and the current value of the recurrent state, ht minus one. And in NMAN networks, what is done is that you compute some matrix vector product for xt. So you would have a first matrix which is specific to the input element, and then you would have a second matrix which is now dealing with the current value of the recurrent state, and you design, you dimension them, of course, such that the result of the matrix vector multiplication for the first here term produce a vector of dimension q, which is the dimension of the recurrent state, right? And then you would do some processing also for ht minus one that produce another vector of size q. You would sum them all together, both together, you would obtain another vector of size q. Then of course you could still define an offset b as before, which in this case would also be a vector of size q. It would be summed to the previous values. And then finally, you would apply the sigmoid function at every element of this vector of size q, and that would produce the new value for ht. Right? Then you could do the same for yt, except that now you would, in this case, if yt is just a scalar value, then you would just squash or project the recurrent state into a scalar number by some, for example, some other linear combination with another set of weights, which would be specific here to this operation. Again, you could define some offset b that would produce altogether a scalar value, and then you would pass this value through a nonlinear activation function, such as the sigmoid function or some other activation function like the hyperbolic tangent or the ReLU activation function. So when you do that, there is also a nice connection with the multilayer perceptron, because it's as if these blue boxes corresponding to the phi values were just regular, fully connected layers of the same kind that we've been defining when we talked about the multilayer perceptron. Except that now you would have a variable number of layers in the network. If you view the recurrent network as some kind of unrolled multilayer perceptron. And also what is also different is that this layer would share the same weights, right? Because they would reuse at every time step the same W matrices. Even though we have three matrices, these three matrices would be reused over and over at every time step T. All right. So to illustrate how this thing works, we'll use today an example, a benchmark example, which for humans is quite easy, but for a machine learning model may be quite complicated. So we'll try to build a model that will learn to recognize sequences, right, that may be of variable length. So in the training data, we'll assume that I will have sequences from size 1 to 10. And the goal of the benchmark problem would be to tell whether the sequence, the input sequence, is a palindrome or not. So palindrome is a sequence which can be read in both directions, so from left to right or from right to left, that will produce the same sequence. And so for example, this sequence is a palindrome because if you look at the reverse sequence, that would produce the same sequence, right? So 1, 2, 3, 2, 1 is the same as the reverse, which is 1, 2, 3, 2, 1. The same for 2, 1, 2, it's a palindrome. And the third sequence would not be a palindrome because its reverse is not equal to the original sequence. Of course, sequences made of a single element are also palindrome. And this, the last one would not be a palindrome. So for us, it's quite easy. That's a task we can solve easily, but you will see that for a neural network, it's not too easy. All right, so what I did was to just define one such Hellman network, and then I train this network on some training data that I generated. If I remember correctly, it was about 20 or 25,000 sequences. So some of them in this set, of course, were palindrome, but many were not. And then I train the model for, in this case, 20 epoch on this data. And you see that so what I'm reporting here, of course, is the test loss, so the test cross entropy, and you see that it decreases as we train more and more, but it seems to saturate. And even though it's improving, you see that the network does not seem really to be able to solve the task, because if it was, then the cross entropy would be minimal and would be equal to zero. Right? But it's really not the case. So it seems that this network, this recurrent neural network, has not been able to fundamentally understand what makes a sequence a palindrome or not. But still, you can learn something from the training data. So one thing that you could try to do to improve the accuracy of this model for this particular problem, but actually this something you could do on many other instances of sequence classification, would be to use bidirectional recurrent neural networks. So this is an inductive bias that you would basically put structurally in this neural network, and which would be to say that, the direction that I'm using to ingest the elements, right? It's in this case, you have to, of course, read the sequence from left to right, but since we know all the sequence before processing it, maybe it could also make sense to process that same sequence in reverse, right? And so instead of processing it from 1 to t, we could maybe process it backward from t to 1, right? And so what you could do is maybe to have two recurrent neural networks, one for ingesting the original sequence forward, and another one for ingesting the sequence backward. Right? And at the end, you would have two sequences of recurrent states, one for the forward processing, a second one for the backward processing. And then you could use these two vectors together, for example, to produce the prediction. Right? And so this is what is called bidirectional recurrent neural network. Right? As I just said, the resulting recurrent state of the bidirectional recurrent neural network would be the concatenation of the two resulting sequences of recurrent states. So it seems that on the palindrome problem, it's the perfect thing to do, right? Because if the network, for example, ingests the sequence once forward and then a second time backward in the reverse direction, then it could be quite easy for the network to see if it's a palindrome, for example, by just checking if the two final recurrent states are identical. And if they are, then it probably means that the sequence of computations regardless of the direction that you use, produce the same value, and that could only happen, or maybe that could be learned to only happen if the sequence is indeed a palindrome. Fortunately, in this problem, this does not work very well. So if you do this trick and train instead of bidirectional recurrent neural network, you barely see any improvement. So there is some small differences, but I would say these are just statistical fluctuations, and I would not say that the difference is significant at all. Right, so too bad it does not work. But that's something which is done very often when you have to produce sequences, is to read the sequence in both directions. There are many problems where that leads actually to some improvement, but not for this specific problem. All right, so another extension of or variation of recurrent neural network would be to basically stack several recurrent neural networks together, one on top of the other. And so you can view basically a recurrent neural network, or RNNs, as layers that would produce themselves sequences of the same size as the size of the input sequence. And so that means you start with a sequence, then you feed it through a first RNN, and that would produce a new sequence of the same size. And then, as we did for multilayer perceptron, you could stack several of these layers together. So now you could stack several of these RNNs together to produce, for example, a second or third sequence for the previous sequence, from the second sequence that was produced, for example, from the original input sequence. Right? So now you would have the second RNN, which takes as input not the original input sequence, but the sequence of recurrent states, and then would produce itself a new sequence of recurrent states. And you could repeat that for a certain number of layers, let's say L of them, and then finally use the final recurrent state value as input to the final, for example, small MLP, which would be responsible for producing the class label or the vector of probability estimate. Right? So here I use the same letter theta, but of course these RNNs don't have to share the same weights. You could have weights that are specific to the layers that you are considering, and that's usually what is done, of course. All right, so if we try this new architecture, and I think I tried with three layers of recurrent activations, you see that, unfortunately, it's not really improving either. So it seems that all the ideas that you are trying does not really help, at least on this problem. Again, we'll see later on that there are a few examples where this is quite important, but again, not on this problem. All right. So So one of the issues might be that actually we're still having problems with vanishing gradients. So if you have long sequences, and then you just picture in your mind what would be the unrolled graph of computation over these long sequences, then of course the graph would grow linearly with the size of the sequence, right? And so that means we could still have issues with vanishing gradients, and in particular, depending on how we set these activation functions, right? And if I'm using sigmoid activation functions, it's very likely that we'll still have issues with the vanishing gradients. And so that means only, for example, the last layers or the last activations, in this case, the last computation of this graph, we'll be able to learn them, but as we go deeper and deeper and more backward through the graph of computation, the gradients will disappear as before, right? And that's something that will make the optimization very difficult to perform. So there are several tricks. You could use, for example, instead radio activations, but usually in the case of recurrent neural network, we'll see that it's not a good idea. Something that you could do instead is something, is a solution which is actually the same as the solution that we talked about in ResNets, which introduced, if you remember, skip connections. It's basically to design now the recurrent neural network cells such that they include a pass-through or additive pass, such and which would have as purpose or for purpose that the recurrent state does not go repeatedly through a squashing nonlinearity like a sigmoid activation. Right? So instead of just using some phi function, what we would to produce the new HT, the new recurrent state value, what we would do is that we would still compute some value as from HT, but the next recurrent state would not be updated directly from this value only. It would be updated as the sum of the previous value of the recurrent state and the output of this phi function. And if you do that, then you see nicely that when you will compute the backward pass, sorry, I see that my laptop has low battery. Okay. So if you do that, then when you compute the backward pass, the gradients, of course, will still have to go through the blue boxes back to the first activations, for example. But at the same time, the code we would have to traverse all possible paths, they would be also allowed to go through to the pass through, so the connections that you have below through the sum operations, right? And in this case, the gradient will no longer vanish exactly as we had for instance. So in the context of so this is something we'll use. So concretely, one of the mechanisms which is often used in recurrent neural network is called gating, and it's implemented in this way. So the recurrent state will be, for example, a per component weighted average of its previous value, HT minus one, and a full new value, a full new update, HT bar, right? And we will have, so we say that it's a weighted average between these two values, between the current value and some new update. And the weights of this average are defined as a variable ZT, which depend on the input and the recurrent state, current recurrent state value. And for example, and usually we would call them, for example, forget gates. And so how does it work? Well, we would have, as before, the computation of a new recurrent state value, HT, except that now this value is only a proposal for the new recurrent state. So that's why I would call it now HT bar. But otherwise, it would be computed as before, as the output of some function phi, which depends on the next element in the sequence, XT, and the current recurrent state value, HT minus one. Then we would compute some weight value, which would be a value between 0 and 1, right? As the output of some function f, which itself depends on the current token xt and the current or the next token xt and the current value of the recurrent state ht minus 1. And then what we would do is that effectively the next recurrent state value ht would be computed as the weighted average of the current recurrent state HT minus one and the proposal HT bar, right? And the weights would be given by this forget gate ZT. So typically what would happen is that we would design ZT or F as some simple function that could be, for example, some sigmoid activations of some combination of these values. And if you use the sigmoid activation, that means usually the f function will saturate. So it will be either 1 or 0, or rather a value very close to one or a value very close to zero. And when that happens, for example, when ZT is close to one, then this value would be dominant in the average, right? Because 1 minus 1 would be close to 0. And so it's as if you would not be using the proposal value, but would just you would basically just maintain the current value for the next time step, right? And if, on the other hand, ZT is close to 0, then what would effectively happen is that you would forget about the current recurrent state value, and instead instead replace it with the proposal value HT bar. Right? And so when you put all these things together, this is the kind of recurrent cell that you would obtain. So this is just some kind of circuit diagram, but that corresponds to the same equations as here. What you see is that, so this is basically the cell, the piece of computation, the RNN cell that would be applied over and over over the element of the sequence. So here I'm just zooming in on some, at some time step t, right? And at this time step, you would ingest the next token xt and the current recurrent state value ht minus 1, right? And then basically what happens is one of the two following scenarios. Either you would keep the current recurrent state value, right? And in this case, what would happen is that ht would just pass through the path above in the cell, right? And that would happen when zt is close to 1. Right. In this case, the signal of HT minus 1 would pass through the cell and then would be just basically copied or almost copied as output to the cell. Or if ZT is close to 0, right, then you would basically kill this connection, right, through the, when you do the element-wise product. It's as if you were killing the signal, and you will replace the current recurrent state value by what is done here in this part of the cell. So you would compute simply a new value for the recurrent state that would give the proposal, and then that's the value that would be then produced as output at this time step, right? And you see that with this mechanism, we have this nice property that the signal is allowed the gradients would not disappear when you compute the backward pass, because there would always be a way for the signal to pass through the cell, for example, through this through the above connection, through the above pass in the recurrent cell. Right? Of course, you may still have issues with what would happen in the part below. But usually that would be good enough for the network to be able to be trained. Right. So this is called gating because this is also very similar to what you would do in electronics, where you would have this kind of gates that would have that would take Boolean values 0 or 1, and then given these Boolean values would then enable this or this behavior in the next part of the circuit, right? So this is exactly the same kind of thing we would mimic in these recurrent neural network cells implementing gating. All right, so a first instance of this gating mechanism in recurrent neural network is known as LSTM, or long short-term memory model. It was proposed almost 25 years ago by Okrechter and Schmidhuber. And it's basically a variation of this mechanism, but a bit more complicated. So there are a few changes. The first one is that now in this model, the recurrent state is split into two parts. So we would maintain two vectors. The first one is called CT. And it's known as the cell state. And then we would have a second part, HT, which correspond to the output state. And then in this cell, there are three gates that are used to make updates to these values. First, we have a forget gate FT, which will basically select the cell state information that you want to erase at this step. Then we'll have an input gate IT, which selects the state cell state information to update, so which of the elements of CT to update. And then finally, an output gate OT, which will select the information from the cell state that should be produced as output to the cell, so HT. So let's see how that works step by step. So again, we have a cell, which now is this LSTM recurrent neural network cell, which here we just consider at one time step T. At this time step, we have two inputs, or three inputs now. We have the next token XT, we have the first part of the recurrent state, so we have HT minus one, which now is called the output state, and the second part, the other, or the first part, the bottom, the top part, which is the cell state CT, so in this case, we would have CT minus one. So the first piece of computation which is done in this cell is to compute the value of the forget gate, so FT, which again is defined very similarly as before. We would have some matrix vector multiplication of the inputs. So in this case, the inputs would be the concatenation of the recurrent state value, of the output state value HT minus one with the next token XT plus some offset. And then that would produce at the end some vector of size identical to the size of the cell state, right, of values between 0 and 1. So typically here the sigma would be the sigmoid activation function. Now, we would have also in this part in the middle, the computation first of the input input gate, which is defined identically to the forget gate, except that of course we would have weights values, so the matrix W and the offset vector would be dedicated to this gate, but otherwise it's the same, also using the sigmoid activation. And then we would have a proposal, the computation of a proposal, CT bar, for the cell state. In this case, it's computed as, again, some matrix vector multiplication of the output state and the current token, plus some offset. And then the activation function, which is used in LSTM for this, is an hyperbolic tangent. Okay, and then the next part would be to actually make the update to the cell state, right? And so this happens in two steps. The first step is to basically erase some of the current value in the cell state. And this is what you would do when you compute the element-wise product between the forget gate and the current cell state value, CT minus one, right? So it's as if you were taking the vector and then just erasing some of the entries in this vector, because FT is either a value close to one or a value close to zero, at least typically. And then the second step is basically to introduce, to add new values that have been defined through the cell state proposal CT bar and the input gate. So that means CT bar would be a full vector of size, I don't know which size I put, but let's say of size Q. And then we would have another vector of size Q, which corresponds to the input forget gate, to the input gate. Then that would basically select just some of the entries now of that proposal. And then the selected entries would be added to the cell state vector, right? And then that would produce effectively the next cell state value CT. What is also interesting here is that the fact that the candidate, the cell state proposal was computed using as nonlinear activation the hyperbolic tangent, which has the properties of taking values between minus 1 and 1. So that means when you take the when you will make the sum here, you can either add new values. So for example, that could be used to increment some counters. That means this cell state can be could be learned to act as counters that you increment if the value is close to plus 1. But also, because of the hyperbolic tangent, that value that is produced could have a negative value up to minus 1. And similarly, you could learn to decrement some counter through this cell state. Or maybe the value would just be some interval value between minus 1 and 1, maybe closer to 0. In this case, how that would be used is less clear. But it's really on purpose that this activation function is not just a sigmoid activation, it's an hyperbolic tangent, because that means we'll make the that will make the cell being able to not only increment but decrement values of its cell state. All right. Then the last operation, the last two equations that are defining the LSTM is the equations controlling the output. And so here, it's about the computation of the next output state, HT, which again, you would use this gating mechanism to compute the OT output gates as the sigmoid activations of some matrix vector product between the inputs plus some offset. And then the purpose of this would be basically to say that, okay, at every time step, the cell would basically select some of the entries from CT and would expose them to the outside world by passing the, by first selecting only some of them through the output gate, and then by also passing them through some saturation function, nonlinear saturation function, which in this case would be the hyperbolic tangent function. So it's as if you had some quantized version HT, some quantized version of CT, which would be produced as output, and that would be the value of HT. Right. So now, if you use this cell, this LSTM, and you try to learn this problem of classifying palindrome sequences, there now we see that the results are much, much better. And if I... So here I've stopped after 20 epochs, but you see that actually that's also the same for the other models. I could have kept training the network for longer, and you see that it would have improved more and more. Eventually, it would saturate at some point. It's not clear if it would reach exactly zero, but at least we see that the network is really being able to solve that same problem much better than all the three previous attempts. And one of the main reasons, as would say, is because really of this gating mechanism that allows the gradients to flow through when you run automatic differentiation. All right, so a final, what time is it? Okay, it's 10. I will just go over this last variation, and then we'll have a coffee break. So there is another popular cell. There are actually many more than that, but the LSTM and this one are really the most popular one. And so this text cell is called the Gated Recurrent Unit, GRU. It was proposed 7 years ago. And basically, it's like a simplified version of the LSTM. It will use only two gates instead of three. And we'll have an update gate ZT and a reset gate RT. And even though this GRU cell is actually, you can show formally that it's strictly weaker than an STM, on many practical problem that involves, for example, language or speech processing, then usually they perform similarly well as LSTMs, but with fewer parameters, right? Because the parameters that you would need here are all the parameters ties to the three gates, and here with the GRUs, we would have only two of this set of parameters, right? And so the equations would have only four of them for the GRU. So we'd have the computation of the ZT, the update gate and the reset gate RT. So the reset gate is... Okay. So it's working really, it's really close to this first, actually this first version of the gate itself. So we would have the update gate ZT, which is responsible for computing this average, weighted average between the current recurrent state value HT minus one and some proposal value HT bar, right? With the modification, with the difference that the value of HT bar would also be computed on the basis of some other gates, the reset gate. And so in this case, what we would do is that we would compute the proposal not directly over the concatenation of HT minus one and XT, but over the concatenation of RT, of the element-wise product between RT and HT minus one and XT. And that will have the effect that to compute the proposal, you will basically allow the cell to basically select the entries that it does not want to use. And so this will happen by just setting some of the RT values to zero. And so that will discard, they will be then set as zero. And then you will compute the matrix vector product between this reset recurrent state vector and the next token, and you would pass them through some nonlinear activation, which in this case would be the hyperbolic tangent. And as before, you see that the gradient would be allowed to pass through nicely through the cell, again through the pass above. So HT, if you compute the backward pass and follow the pass back to HT minus one, there is this pass here that goes through the plus operation, then the product, and then back here to HT. So in this case, this computation would not involve any squashing nonlinear activation function, and therefore the gradient would not vanish along this path. Right. Now, if you compare then the performance that you would obtain on our palindrome problem, for the GRU, you see that we obtain performance that are very close to the LSTM, just a bit worse. And I would say even that in this case, it's just bad luck. I'm quite sure for some other value of the random seed I use, we could see results that are flipped. So the difference that you see, I would not say that it's really significant, at least on this problem. Okay, there is one question in the chat. If we erase an entry, thanks to the forget gate, so suppose you are talking about the LSTM, and that we do not replace it with a new value, thanks to IT, what happens? Have we lost some of the data inside IT? Yes, that's correct. It could happen that at some point, the network just decide to forget some value to activate the forget gates. In this case, that would erase some entries, and at the same time, because in this case, That depends on the problem, of course, but at the same time, would then decide to not update or to not replace this erased value with some new value, right? So this is a degree of freedom which is indeed allowed by this architecture, which, if you look closely, is actually not possible with the GRU unit. Wait. You could. Yeah, because you are combining the reset directly together with the computation of the proposal. So it's very unlikely that the proposal will still be sparse after having reset some entries in the current recurrent state value. Right. So that's a small but indeed significant difference, which makes usually the GRU, just as I said, a bit weaker. So that means there are some problems that the GRU will not be able to solve, even though the LSTM will be able to solve. Okay, another next question by Jonathan. In terms of computation time, is there any difference between LSTM and GRUs when using GPUs? Well, the I would say the GRU is a bit more lightweight because if you just count how many operations you have to perform at every time step, you have to perform less of them because there are only two gates. Well, for example, for the LSTM, you would add we had the forget gate, the input gate, and then the output gate. But usually, unfortunately, running recurrent neural networks on GPUs is typically slower than running big convolutional neural networks because of the sequential nature of the computation. You would profit really from the GPU only if it have every step you have to compute a lot, which in this case may not be the case, because you would be basically ingesting small values one by one. So for example, the vector representation of individual words typically, and that's usually, I mean, this size is usually not that large. So you would not basically use at 100% of efficiency your GPU, typically with RNNs, regardless of LSTM or GRU. All right. Okay, then before the break, I also want to show this plot. So we see that, okay, from this plot where I'm showing you the test losses of the five different recurrent neural networks, we could say that, okay, the LSTM and the GRUs, they really seem to have understood what makes a sequence a palindrome, right? But because they are performing much better. But remember, when I built my training data, I said that I would use training sequences of size 1 to 10. So if really they understand what makes a sequence a palindrome sequence, they should be able, we hope, they should be able to also process sequences that are longer than 10 elements. And so when you compute the cross entropy loss of the GRU and the LSTM that we have just obtained previously, but now on sequences that are possibly larger than 10, then you see, for example, here on this part on the right, that actually they are performing worse, and actually the performance really deteriorates very quickly as the size of the sequence grow larger and larger beyond the maximum sequence that was seen during training. So for the LSTM, it gets worse, but less quickly than for the GRU. But in the two cases, you see that even though they were able to solve quite well the problem for sequences from 1 to 10, As soon as you go out of the assumptions of the training data, this model actually do not generalize very well. There are tricks actually to improve this generalization performance, but it is outside of the scope. This is just something I just wanted to highlight again. As soon as you go out of the assumptions of your training data, what will happen is not clear and can be quite arbitrary depending on the architecture that you have and the indicative biases that were put in this architecture. So here we see that it does not break completely. I would say that for sizes of 11 or 12, for example, they are still performing better than the best performance of the three previous architectures. But as you would take sequences that are larger and larger or longer and longer, then you see that it does not work at all after some point. All right. So now I think it's a good time for the coffee break. We'll resume in 10 minutes at 10:25, and I will show you a quick demo, another example here with code now, showing some differences between, I would say, vanilla recurrent neural networks, like the Hellman networks that we've seen, and the LSTM type of recurrent cell. All right, so see you in 10 minutes. All right, so welcome back. So I see that we have two questions. One on Discord from François, who asks, I guess one can use RNNs to learn a language model, which is basically learning a probability distribution P of XT given a previous sequence from X1 to T minus 1. And then he asked, would it be the preferred architecture to do that, or are there better ones? So historically, indeed, that has been one of the main way to implement language model by using recurrent neural networks. And I will show you in a few slides how that works in a few more details. But as I also said, today, when it comes to language model precisely, we are no longer really using recurrent neural networks. Instead, what is now really popular and which has demonstrated really incredible performance is to use transformer network. And we'll see that, how do they work and what they are next week. Then we have a second question from Jonathan. He asks, in time series forecasting, is it useful to use LSTM to process features with sequence information and then MLPs for other features and then to combine them to finally make the prediction? So indeed, that's would be one way to basically ingest data that you may have of various kinds. And so you would have different smaller neural networks that are responsible for processing, for example, vector or tabular data that would be regular MLPs. And then you would also have with this data, I don't know, sequential data, maybe of arbitrary sizes. This data could be processed with LSTMs, and which is in what is then indeed nice that then that would transform this data of arbitrary sizes into fixed size vectors. And then that means now these two kinds, these two modalities of data could be recombined, for example, typically just concatenated, and then fed as input to a third neural network, for example, again, an MLP, in order then to produce some final predictions. So indeed, that's something that's a good baseline that I will try myself. I think really that makes sense to do it like this. All right, so as promised, now I will show you some code example. And so we'll consider, again, an example of many to one, so a sequence classification problem. This is an experiment which is taken from the original LSTM paper from 1997. And the goal is to, as I said, classify sequences, except that the sequences are a bit special. Maybe I will show you one that will be easier to understand. So we would have sequences such like those. Right, So what you see here is that it's some sequence of some size, and the problem is defined such that the first element is always B for begin, and the final element is always E for end. And then the intermediate elements are all random values, which could be A, B, C, or D. Except for two of those elements that could be located at some random positions within the sequence. So we would have a first element, I would say around the first quarter of the sequence, which could be either X or Y. And then later on in this sequence, at some also random location, you would have another element which would take also value X or Y, right? And then depending on the combination of these two values, so here we would have two X values, this X here that you see, and then a second X here, that would correspond to a third class, which is called Q for this problem. And so the problem is defined such that if in the sequence you have X at some point and then X again, then the sequence is classified as class Q. If you have X and Y, then it's the class label is R. If you have Y and X, it's S. And if you have Y and Y, it's U. Okay. That again, that's not too difficult to understand, at least for us, but for a neural network, that may be much more difficult. And the reason is that there can be a lot of noise, and the fact that the positions exactly of the element in the sequence of these X or Y values is random. Okay? And so effectively, the sequence, so here what you are seeing, I will set the difficulty to easy. So in this problem generator, you have four different levels of difficulty. Easy, that would correspond to short sequences, and up to hard, in which you would have sequences of up to size 100. So here we would have one of these sequence which has been generated at random, which is represented in this way. Okay. So we have B, B, X, C, X, C, B, E. So we have here 8 elements. Right. And how many do we have here? 9. Okay, and then that sequence would be itself encoded into vector of numbers, right? And so here you see the representation of that sequence as a sequence of vectors. If we set the difficulty to normal, you see that we would have longer sequences. And so you would have as many vectors here as we have elements in the sequence, right? And you see that the decoded version of this list of vectors would correspond to this sentence or to this sequence. Okay, but let's start with easy. So that's the problem that we want to solve, right? And so in PyTorch, most of the models I've talked about are implemented and they are available. And so you can use the RNN modules from the NN, Torch NN module, which allows you to just, it's as if you had directly access to this cell, to this Lego brick. And then of course you can compose it with all the other kind of layers or other Lego bricks that you have available in PyTorch. So we would have, in a sense, some kind of recurrent neural network. So in this case, it corresponds to an L-MAN neural network in which we have to specify the input size, the size of the recurrent state, the nonlinearity that we use. In this case, let's say we use a ReLU. You have also to define in which way the data is presented. And then we define, so that would correspond to our phi function. Yes. And then you would have the var phi function that would compute the output of the network itself, the final output. So for example, to produce the classification. In this case, it would be just a linear, fully connected layer. And that would correspond to the logits that we would use to then and pass on to a softmax. But that would be done directly when you use the cross entropy loss in PyTorch. Right, so this you should be familiar with if you did the homeworks. And similarly, we do the same, but using an LSTM cell instead of the vanilla Hellman network, right? All right. Then we'll define a training loop. So nothing really special to say here. It's the same kind of loops you have been writing yourself. We'll do the same for obtaining predictions on test data. And then we'll put everything together. So we'll have the actual loop over a few epochs. And then at every epoch, we'll do a full pass on the training data. We'll compute some statistics along the way, and the number of correct predictions, and the cross entropy loss values. Similarly for the test data, okay? And given this boilerplate code, I'm now ready to train my first simple recurrent neural network on this problem. And I will make sure that verbose is equal to true. Okay, so it's training. Okay, so you see that it seems to have understood something. So the loss really decreases, but the accuracy is still far from being perfect. So it's only reaching 50%. So maybe we would need to train for longer. So let's instead use 30 epochs. Okay, you see here that okay, it did not train for a long time, and then eventually it reached a configuration of the model parameters in which it managed to solve the task. So as we'll see, the initialization is actually quite important, and it may take a long time before the network is able to make sense of the data. So maybe let's just try again. See that it's going faster to 50%, 80, 100. And now we've managed to solve it. But you see that indeed, in terms of the accuracy, we reach a plateau. So very quickly it reached 50% accuracy and then finally managed to solve the task fully. So that means it's very likely that it managed to identify two of the classes together. So I don't know. So for example, if it's starting with X, then you should just predict either Q or R, right? And if the first symbol that you recognize is not X but Y, then you should produce as output S or U, right? And if you do that, then the accuracy will reach 50%. And then of course you would need to distinguish between the two subclasses in this group, which depend on the value of the second symbol in the sequence. That's very likely what happens. It first learns to recognize the first symbol and then takes longer to understand that it also has to base its output on the value of the second X or Y symbol in the sequence. But eventually, it gets there and manages to solve the task. Okay, so now let's see what would happen if we had used instead an LSTM. Okay, I'm just training for 10. Let's train for 30 to be fair. Okay, it managed to solve the task as well. You see here that we have the same kind of plateau, except that the first plateau is set at around 75%, which means that it's very likely that one of the four classes was systematically mistaken from some other class, and then eventually it learned to fix this mistake and reach the 100% performance. So here, of course, I set the difficulty to easy. So I was only considering short sequences. So let's say what would happen if you consider problems that are a bit more complicated. So I would just say, for example, setting the difficulty to normal, and you would have sequences of this size, so around 40 tokens in the sequence. You reuse the same architecture in the two cases. Okay, so let's train again for 30 epochs with the Hellman networks. Okay, you see that here it does not manage to solve the task anymore. Maybe if we had trained longer, it could have solved it. And let's see what would happen with the LSTMs. Okay, here we see that it still manages to solve the task and quite quickly. If we increase the number of epochs to really a lot, and let's stick to the same difficulty, so instead using 100 epochs, I'm not showing here the losses, maybe I should have. Alright, so here we see that it does not solve the task, and there was again a phase along which the network was really not making sense of the data, and then eventually it found a configuration in which learning was made possible, and from there on the loss improved. It's also at the same time that the accuracy of course starts increasing. But regardless, it does not manage to solve the task and reaches a performance of 75%, meaning that one of the classes is very likely to be systematically mistaken for some others. Let's see what would happen with the LSTM, and I will turn on the verbose mode. So you see that from one run to the other, the improvement is not always consistent. At least you see that the loss values, they really decrease, at least for the LSTM, consistently, but it does not always translate to an improvement in terms of accuracy. But here we see that it still manages to solve the task and to solve it well. If we do the same, let's say for the hardest difficulty, where the sequences are of size up to 100, you see that the loss does not improve, accuracy does not increase, because it's really having some hard time in learning to identify first that it should make use of this y and x values that appear somewhere in these long sequences. And it's just dominated by a lot of noise in the training data. It's not that it could not learn it, but it's just the fact that it's very difficult to identify the signal in the data. And that's why you see that in this case, the LSTM has not managed to solve the task. And I could have done the same experiment with the Hellman network, it would not have succeeded either. So there is some code for the model evaluation. So this is the network that did not, that just did not manage to stop the task. You see that it manages to solve some of them, for the Q and S classes, but for the others, R and U, it does not. And again, that means, wait, it just basically learned to recognize the first symbol, but not the next in the sequence. So let's now see with the difficulty set to just normal. Okay, eventually we reach almost perfect accuracy. Okay, and eventually we get there. Okay, and this is, okay. So you see that it reaches a loss of zero, right? And I will mention what happens there because I think this is quite interesting. This is what I wanted to talk about in the next slides. Right? And so on this test, the test sequences, you see that it's making correct predictions. So these are some sequences that are fed as input to the network, and then it correctly classifies them all. Even though here at the last iteration, something happened, I suppose. So you see, and this is something I said also during the fourth lecture on training algorithms. You should always look at the losses when you train neural networks. You will learn a lot from that. And here you saw that by only looking at the losses, I could tell you that some of the classes, I could basically understand what was happening with respect to the performance of the network. And just by the values of the losses or the accuracy, you can understand that it's learning to do this, but not to do the rest of the, to solve the remaining part of the problem. So that's a first element. And here also you see that there is this big spike in the test loss. And also there's a spike even though of a smaller amplitude in the train loss. So this is something that typically happens also in a recurrent neural network that we called not the vanishing gradient problem, but the exploding gradient problem. There are cases where the gradient becomes so large that this induces a big change in the loss value. And this is what you see here in this spike. And typically, either this exploding gradient problem will just make the network to have forgotten about everything it has learned before, and you would not be able to recover from this. Or maybe you are lucky, as we were here, and fortunately, even though there was a very bad update or it was applied to the model parameters, it could recover from it. And of course, that's something you would like to avoid, because this is just due to numerical instability, and you don't want to have to deal with that. You would like as much as possible to have a smooth as possible loss curves. And we'll see how to fix that in just a moment. Okay, and then what is also interesting is to understand what is happening inside the cells themselves. So maybe we can set this. So here I will train an LSTM for 100 epochs using a size of size 4, and I will use the moderate. Maybe it's too difficult actually. This one. I will switch to easy. Let's see what's the final performance of this model. Okay, it's not perfect, so I will just maybe just increase to 8. So yes, yeah, the notebooks, I've not shared them, but because they are not mine, but I will add a link where you will find them all. These are taken from another course about deep learning. So here we see that we have a final model that solved the task, right? Now let's see what the model is actually doing on some input sequence. So here what you see is the input sequence, right? So the values are the same, and what you see in this case are 8 values, and that correspond to the vector values of the cell state, so the CT, right? And if you remember the LSTM diagram, we have this the recurrent state, if it's made of two parts, the CT and the HT, right? And it's updated at every step of the sequence, right? So in this case, I set the hidden state to be a size 8. So each CT is a vector of size 8, right? And so each one of the column correspond to one of the CT value, the CT vector value, right? And similarly for H, they are made of vectors of size 8, and we would have as many of them as the size of the sequence. So what is interesting to see, so here the values themselves are color-coded. So a value which is plain red would be a large positive value, and a value which is blue would be a negative value, and values that are closer to zero would be almost white. And you see that if you look at what is happening, how the cell states are updated, you see that more they stay more or less constant up to maybe some minor variations for the first part of the sequence, and really there is a significant change in their value when the network hits a token which corresponds in this case to some X value. Because indeed, that's precisely what makes a sequence of be of this class of this other class. So the network really has identified that it should basically remember and store this information somewhere, and the only way it could store that is precisely in the set state when it sees one of these X or Y values. You see, for example, that here after the X token, the values get close, that becomes more negative, so we transition from Y to blue, and similarly here we transition maybe from Y to blue. From blue to red, and so on and so on. So it seems that really now the network has stored some information that it knows will be relevant then to solve eventually the task. And then as we proceed further through the sequence, you see that the cell state more or less stay constant, maybe at least after two or three more tokens. You see that the color do not change any longer. And here, finally, we hit the second token, X or Y. The change in color is not so obvious. I would say that it has not even changed anything. And it might be the case that it knows that, okay, from this value, it will just directly output as a prediction for the class. The first class, which I don't know for XX was the class Q, if I remember correctly. And what could have happened, I suppose, is that if on the other hand the second symbol was the Y, then we would have observed a change here in the values that are stored. And then from this now updated version of the cell state, it knows that from this value, it should associate a different output, so in this case, a different class value. So let's see if we can change that. Test data. Suppose it's this. Yes. So here we are hitting first the Y symbol. Then there is a change again of value. And yeah, maybe I would like to have Y and X or X and Y. Y. Ah, there. So here we have a first symbol, then there is a change of color, for example, transition from red to white. And then the second symbol is different. We have then the X, and you see that again we have this transition of value. Right? So it really learns that I suppose exactly this process that, okay, the first symbol just set the cell state to some value that would be associated to a default class. And then depending on the value of the second symbol, will either keep the current cell state unchanged or update it because it should actually predict the other class for the problem. All right, so that's it for this. I will now switch back to the slides. If you have questions about this, now is the time. Otherwise, I will just move on. Nope. All right. So as we've just observed together, we may hit this issue of having exploding gradients. So it's really this phenomenon where at some point, something happens, there is some numerical instability, and you have a big jump in the loss value. And so in the case that we saw together, fortunately, we were able to recover from that. But here you see that on this other example, which corresponds to a different network, you know, a different problem, but it's just showing the same exploding gradient phenomenon. You see that there is a big jump, and unfortunately, the network is not able to recover, or at least it recovers, but after some after many updates, and even it does not manage to reach the accuracy or the loss value it had before this exploding gradient. So this is a problem. So even though we've been using, for example, gated units, and the motivation was to avoid this vanishing gradient problem, nothing prevents them actually from exploding, right? And this is precisely what we've observed with an LSTM based on gates. We observe this exploding gradient. So there is a heuristic strategy which is often solved in practice, which usually is sufficient to solve the problem, even though it does not come with strict guarantees. It's just to basically clip the norm of the gradient. So at every step, when you run automatic differentiation, you get some gradient value. And so instead of using this gradient value, what you would do is to clip the values of the gradients if the values are too large in magnitude, right? And so gradient norm clipping is basically implementing this strategy. It rescales the norm of the gradient to a fixed threshold delta when the norm of the gradient is above this threshold delta. Right? So effectively, the gradient that you then pass on to the optimization algorithm would not be the one that you compute from automatic differentiation, but would be a rescaled version of that gradient, would be a clipped version of that gradient if the magnitude is too large. Right? So you would this would correspond to the direction of the gradient, right? The original Nabla F gradient. And then you would multiply this either by the original amplitude, the original norm of the gradient, if and only if this norm is below some threshold delta. So that means basically you would not make any change to the gradient. But on the other hand, if that norm is larger than delta, then you multiply by delta, And effectively, that would have clipped the norm up to delta. And usually that's enough to prevent these big jumps in the loss that you've observed and solve most of the exploding gradient problems. And so typically that's if you want to do that in PyTorch or in some other framework, that's something that comes as an argument to the optimization algorithm that you use. So let's say use Adam or RMSProp or SGD. If you look at the argument that you can pass to the constructor of this object, usually you will find some clip or clip gradient or clip norm parameter that you can use to implement this, to enable this strategy. All right. The last thing that I need to talk about when it comes to recurrent neural network is how to actually initialize the weight of this of these cells. So if you remember when you talked about multi-layer perceptrons, we had this strategy that we should initialize the weights such that it more or less preserves the variance across layers during the forward pass, but also the variance of the gradient during the backward pass. And we saw a few strategies like the Lequin or the Xavier initialization that you can do for this purpose. Here, the situation is a bit different because we are actually, it's as if in the recurrent cell, we had an MLP, but in which the layers share the same parameters, right? It's a bit more tricky to define the initialization. And also we don't know in advance for how many iterations we'll have to run the cell because the size of the sequence is arbitrary, right? It could be 10, but it could be 1,000. That's something you don't control typically. It depends on the problem that you are considering. So for this, I will switch to the iPad to explain how you can, a strategy, it's not the only one, but one good strategy that you can use to initialize the weights of the network. So it's called orthogonal initialization. And so when we compute the recurrent state update, and let's just stick the L-MAN network, but you can use the same strategy for the other types of cells that we've seen. We saw that, for example, the recurrent state was defined as some sigmoid activation of some W matrix times the next token plus some other matrix times the previous or the current state value plus some offset p, right? Here, what we'll say is that we'll make some assumptions just to study the problem, right? And so we'll say that we don't have any bias, right? We'll say that we don't even have an activation function. And that's an assumption which is fair to do if we are in the regime where we are close to zero. So if the input value to the sigmoid function is close to zero, then a linear approximation is a good approximation of the sigmoid activation. And we'll say that the input element is always equal to zero, right? So effectively, it's as if here I'm making really some strong assumptions, but you will see that it works well enough. It's as if the next recurrent state value was just computed as some linear combinations of the previous recurrent state value. Right? And to simplify the notations, because now I'm just dealing with one single weight matrix, I will just say that this is equal to W transpose times HT minus 1. Okay, then I will define, then if we have a sequence of size n, then effectively to compute Hn, what we are doing is that we would start with H0, right? And we would multiply it by this matrix W, right? And to make things even simpler, let's just say that the W is in the correct format, so we can drop the transpose operator, right? And so when you compute, when we compute this W times H0, that would then produce H1, and this H1, we would multiply it itself by W to produce H2, right? And then we would repeat that for a certain number of times, right? To produce the final output Hn. So in this form, right? What we have is that Hn is basically W to the power of n times H0, right? And let's say that we initialize H0 with some vector made of ones, right? So it's as if we were just computing W to the power of n. And ideally what we would like to have is that for this guy, so W to the power of n to not vanish nor to explode as the value of n increases. All right. So how to do that? So I will just make now a digression and telling you about something you should all know, all remember, is the Fibonacci sequence. So as you know, the Fibonacci sequence is a sequence where you start with two integer values, typically 0 and 1, and then you define the next, in this case, for example, the third value, as the sum of the two previous ones, right? So in this case, the sum of the two of 0 and 1 is 1. Then you take the next element, is the sum of 1 and 1, is 2. Then you take the sum of the two previous ones, is 3, then 5, then 8, then 13, then 21, then 34, then 55, then 89, and so on and so on. So this sequence actually grows very fast. But it might actually be interesting to understand the rate at which the sequence grow, right? So this is something you can study formally. And so in matrix form, the computation of the sequence would be defined in this way. So we would have that fk plus 2 and fk plus 1, where fk corresponds to the k element in the Fibonacci sequence is defined in matrix form as 1, 1, 1, 0 times fk plus 1 fk, right? So when you do that, you just compute the next, you compute what is actually happening is that fk plus 2 is computed as fk plus 2, this one, is computed as the sum, so as this dot product of this row with this column, so it's the sum of fk plus 1 and fk that produces fk plus 2, and fk plus 1 is just copied from the first entry of this vector call. Right? And so now if we have f0 being equal to 1, 0, right, then we recover the Fibonacci sequence, right? And we would have that fk plus 1 is equal to a fk, which is equal to, then we can just apply this definition recursively, right? And we would find that we would obtain a to the power of k plus 1 times f0. Okay? Where a is indeed maybe these notations are a bit confusing. So here, this is a vector, this is a vector, this is a vector, and this is a vector. And so these f vectors are not the same as these ones. These really correspond to elements of the sequence. And now I would be, this f would be pairs, like the first pair would be 1, 0, then the next would be, so f1 bar would be equal to 1, 1, and so on and so on, right? And such that this matrix A is equal to our matrix 1, 1, 1, 0. Okay? Now, my question was, how fast does the Fibonacci sequence grow? And so what we can do or observe is that the matrix A, right, it's a matrix which can be diagonalized. And if you do that, then you would diagonalize it into a product of three matrices, so matrix X, so matrix lambda, and then some matrix, and then the same matrix X, sorry, S, but taking its inverse. And in this case, we would have that S is equal to the golden number, which is usually denoted by the phi symbol, minus the golden number, 1, 1, and lambda is a diagonal matrix in which, in this case, the elements on the diagonal, the first one would correspond to the golden number, and the second one to minus the inverse of the golden number. Otherwise, we would have zero entries, because this is a diagonal matrix. And now, what is nice is that if you take, if you compute, if you want to take the power of our A matrix, it's as if we're taking the power of this guy, right? And this corresponds to the power of the diagonal matrix, and you don't take the power to the S matrices. And since this guy here is a diagonal matrix, this is something which corresponds itself to it's equal in this case to our diagonal element, right? But taken to the power n. And we still have zero. Okay? So that means basically the rate of convergence or the rate of increase of a to the power of n, so of the Fibonacci sequence, is something which grows exponentially fast with the golden ratio here phi. Okay, so that's something actually we can use then to better initialize the neural network, right? Because basically what we would like to do is to find some parametrization of the weights such that maybe its diagonalization will lead to some matrix, right? Such that when you take these things to the power of n or to any power, the norm will stay more or less the same, right? And so we would like to basically design the values such that the norm of this guy will neither vanish nor explode, right? And so formally, so this is a theorem now. So let's define, let rho of A be defined as the spectral radius of the matrix A, which is what? Which is the maximum value, right? Of the absolute value of the eigenvalues of this matrix A. So you take, compute all the eigenvalues, you take their absolute value. So you would have lambda 1, lambda 2, up to lambda d, if d is the size of this matrix. And then you take the max value. And this max value is known as the spectral radius of the matrix. And then this theorem says, and we'll not prove it, that if the spectral radius is basically smaller than 1, right, then the limit as n tends to infinity of the norm of the nth power of that matrix will go to 0. So that means when the spectral radius of the matrix A is smaller than 1, then eventually the values will vanish in norm to 0. And on the other hand, if the spectral radius is larger than 1, then we'll have the opposite scenario where the norm basically explodes. Plus infinity. And then what is interesting is that if, on the other hand, so what could happen from this diagonalization is that if we were to make the values here on the diagonal to be either equal to 1 or minus 1, right, then if you take the power of this matrix, you would take either 1 or minus 1 to the power of n, right? And that would stay bounded, right? If you take 1 to the power of n, that remains 1. And if you take minus 1 to the power of n, that takes either the value minus 1 or 1. But that's a value which stays bounded, right? So this is precisely the scheme that we can use when it comes to initializing properly the weight of this recurrent cell, is to design it such that if we take, so it's designed this W matrix such that its diagonalized version will have values on the diagonal here that are either equal to 1 or minus 1. Because in this case, the n power will neither vanish nor explode and will not be in any of these two situations here. And one way to do that is to say that the matrix A should be orthogonal. Because if it's orthogonal, then it's a matrix which is also diagonalizable and with the properties that all the eigenvalues are either equal to minus 1 or 1, right? And because of that, it will remain bounded. Okay? So I will switch back to the slide to show you that with the video. So you have this explanation in the slides. It's the same, but I wanted to do it on the iPad so that I make the development more slowly. And this is this would be a matrix A, right, which spectral radius is smaller than one. And I told you that according to this theorem, then A to the power of n should vanish. And indeed, as you compute the power of this matrix, you see that the value just disappear and they all tend to zero. On the other hand, if you start with a matrix A, which spectral radius is larger than one, if you take the nth power of that matrix for n increasing, then you see that the norm increases and basically the activation explodes. That's the situation we wanted to avoid at all costs. And on the other hand, if you initialize the matrix as an orthogonal matrix, right, which norm will remain bounded now, then as n increases, you see that you have some changes in values, that's expected, but you don't have any vanishing nor any exploding of the activation. And so that's one of the strategies you can use in recurrent cells when it comes to initializing the weight matrices, is to initialize them with random orthogonal matrices. It's not always necessary, but it might be helpful. If you notice that you, in some problem, you don't manage to train anything, it might be a good idea to try with orthogonal initialization and see if that helps. Of course, as you train more and more the network, you may the matrix W may no longer be orthogonal, right? And therefore, you still the gradient exploding, the exploding gradients may still creeping, but that might happen more later during training. Okay. A last comment about this is that because we do observe exploding activations in recurrent neural networks, it's also the reason why usually in this cell we would prefer squashing saturating nonlinearity activation functions such that the hyperbolic tangent or the sigmoid activation, even though we know that they would lead to vanishing gradient, at the same time these same cells, this same activation function, allow the activations to remain bounded and therefore the gradient to not explode, right? And so this is why typically we use them jointly actually with this gating mechanism, because the gating mechanism will then allow still for the gradient to pass through, even though some of the paths may be saturated because of this activation function. But actually, that's only true for the forward pass, and you may still have problems when computing the backward pass. Okay, so do you have questions about this before I jump into the applications? Okay, actually I think it's a good time to make a break. So if you have questions, just put them in the chat. Let's resume maybe in just 5 minutes or 8 minutes at 11:30 for the last part of today's lecture. All right, so welcome back for the last and third part of the of today's lecture. So hopefully it will be a bit lighter, or much lighter actually, than the two first parts. So first I will cover a few applications of recurrent neural networks, exactly the same kind of recurrent neural networks that we have seen together. And then I want to expand on architectures that go beyond dealing with sequences, and briefly mentioning a few things about graph neural networks, and then finally neural computers. So one of the first tasks, and that's the one we started with, was the task of sentiment analysis, in which the goal would be to basically give a sentence made of words to predict the sentiment which is associated to this sentence. So, for example, positive, negative, or neutral. That's typically the three classes that are considered in sentiment analysis. Could maybe have more degrees of variations, but let's say there are three classes to predict. And so what you see here is an architecture for this problem, and it's made of several different neural networks, but some of them are precisely recurrent neural networks of the kind we have seen. So typically, so this would be a system to actually ingest a whole document made of, for example, several sentences. And so what you would have is that first you would divide the document into sentences, and then the sentences into words. And each one of these words would be represented by some vector that we call the word representation, right? So here you would have the representation of the first sentence as a sequence of five vectors, or actually L1 of them. And then you would have the second sentence, which would be made of different words, and the length of this second sentence could be different from the previous sentence, and so on and so on. And then what is done in this architecture is that you ingest the sequence first, independently, through some CNN / LSTM network. So it's a composition here of a small compnet together with an LSTM to process the whole sentence, right? And that finally would produce a representation, a fixed size representation of that sentence. And you would do that for all sentences in the document. So effectively, you would have now reduced the sequence of sentences as a sequence of sentence representations, right? That would themselves have been computed because a sentence is defined itself as a sequence of a word representations, right? So now, given this sequence of sentence representation, what is done in the architecture is to use a bidirectional recurrent neural network, in which you process the sequence of sentences first forward, and then you would have another set of another cell for processing the sentences backward. So that would correspond to the green arrows. And from this, you would build now a representation of the sentences as a sequence of these smaller vectors that you've computed from the forward and backward passes. So you'd again be left with a set, with a sequence of vectors, and then you'd feed them all through some aggregation function. For example, you'd sum them all together, or you would apply some pooling or whatnot. And then finally, you'd produce a class value by having a final softmax activation layer. Okay, so here you see that it's a composition of, it's a mix between LSTMs, CNNs, stacking, bidirectional, so gated units all together to produce the final output. So again, I think this one is a very nice example, very nice illustration of this thing that I've been telling you about a few times now, is that you should consider these cells or these layers or these units that we see together as some kind of Lego bricks that you can really compose as you wish, depending on the nature of the data that you want to process. The example earlier of Jonathan is another good example, I believe. Another example of application of recurrent neural network would be language models. So this relates to the question from François. And so a language model is a way basically to model language as a Markov chain, in which basically sentences are defined as, well, just sequences of words, obviously, but that would be drawn repeatedly from some distribution. And this distribution would be defined as a conditional distribution for the next word, typically that we would denote here by WT, given all the previous words in the sequence, right? So given a sequence of words one from 1 to t minus 1. And so this is something actually you can implement. You can define this probability distribution as a recurrent neural network, right? And the way you would do that would be to encode the prefix as through the recurrent state of a recurrent cell, right? And then you would say that the probability density associated for the next word, WT, is given by some output layer that you associate to this recurrent state value, right? So for example, if WT is a word in a dictionary made of 20 different possible words, you could model that as a very large softmax activation layer that would just then associate some probability mass to each one of the words and would effectively represent this conditional probability distribution. And then if you want to then synthesize, so generate sentences out of this language model, what you would do is that you start from the empty sequence, you draw a word, right? So you would obtain at the very first step, in this case, the marginal distribution of PW0 or PW1 given nothing, because this is the first word. You draw a value, a realization out of this distribution, and then you'd use this particular realization as the prefix, as the thing that you will condition on to then obtain the next conditional distribution P of W 2 given P w, given given W 1, and then you would draw from this conditional that would then correspond to a realization of the second word given the first, and so on and so on. So effectively, so what you see in the figure is one possible way to do that with recurrent neural network. In this case, it would be a stacked, you would have three recurrent neural networks that are stacked together. The very first one would ingest the words one by one, right? So initially it would be empty. And then at every step, you draw the next word, and you would do that by drawing from this conditional distribution that would represent this distribution here. And then given this realization, that would then correspond to the next word that you feed as input at the next time step. So of course here you don't start with sequences, but you can generate them, then use them to basically define the next token for the recurrent neural networks. So this is an example of this simple architecture. So this is a recurrent neural network that was trained to learn a language model on text. And in this case, on text from Donald Trump's tweets or other speeches. And then what is done in this animation is just you draw random sentences, random text, by drawing words one by one from this language model. And you see that even though if you read them, it does not make any sense, at least maybe some of the sentences alone are actually meaningful. So By that I mean that the long time correlation between the sentences in this case is usually quite poor. Like, I will not allow interviews if the trolls would be a big day for the political proper. So that sentence does not mean anything per se, but still it looks like a proper sentence. And maybe if you just take words in isolation, like groups of five or six, then okay, you get something which makes sense. But the longer term correlations, the longer ideas that you would need to express with long sentences, they are really not well captured. And again, this is what I was saying. This really shows one of the limitations of this kind of architectures. And when we talk about transformer network, you will see that you can generate text like several paragraphs long, in which really there is some you have some consistency. It's really coherent, and you can read them, and that makes more or less sense, at least more sense than what you see here in the animation. So of course the text application is obvious when it comes to sequences, but you should not think that this is the only thing you can do with recurrent neural networks. There are many other ways to define data as sequences. So for example, I really like this one, in which similarly what you are doing is to learn some kind of language model, but not on words, on strokes that you would need to perform if you wanted to, for example, draw a crab, a hole, a pig, and so on. And so in this case, each one of the individual words corresponds to a stroke that you would need to perform. And then the sequence of strokes together would form the full drawing, right? So I will show you the demo. I think it's interesting. So it's a JavaScript demo that you can play with yourself. So it comes with different classes. Basically conditioning the language model to a certain type of drawing, like for example Mona Lisa's or bird, pig. And what you can do with this is to basically initialize the model with a first prefix, with a first set of strokes, and then let just the model draw realizations out of this model, conditionally on the strokes that you have drawn yourself, but also on the ones that are drawn one by one in sequence. So let's see if I draw this, what would happen? So it's the class Mona Lisa, and you see that it's filling. And of course you can draw several times and each time get a different realization. So of course the drawings are very naive and childish, but I think it's still a nice application. Let's see if I now condition on something else. Maybe if I draw the frame, what would happen? Okay, sometimes does not understand that already there is a frame. Let's take another one, I don't know. There are plenty of classes. If you want to waste 1 hour of your time, you can play with this. Let's take the monkey, maybe. And let's draw this, I don't know. This. Sometimes it does not work very well, depends on the class. This one does not seem to work so well. I think I played with the duck one. Let's draw this. No. Not perfect, but you see that the network is able to generate some follow-up to the strokes that I did and to draw something which looks really like a duck. If I draw it in the opposite direction, like here, it understands that it should put the head and the legs in the other direction. So it's nice. And that's something maybe you could do yourself in your programming project. I think it's should not be too difficult, and actually quite fun to play with. It's something you can do with a recurrent neural networks of the same kind that we've seen together. And I'm quite sure you would learn a lot if you were to do that. All right. So of course there is no real purpose of in doing that except just having some fun. a more important application, of course, of recurrent neural network is to do translation. So nowadays, all systems doing translation are powered with neural networks. Most of them with recurrent neural networks, actually. But also more and more with transformer networks. But really, there was a breakthrough a few years ago because of the massive use of recurrent neural networks to solve this task. And so this is an example of a system, the Google's neural machine translation system, which is used, for example, when you use Google Translate. It's one of these networks which behind is actually producing the translations. And it's a big compositions of LSTMs. And you see that you have at first, so this would be the encoder part. So this is an architecture that we'll see over and over. It's whenever you want to produce, to ingest data and then to produce new data out of that, one very generic architecture that you can use is this so-called encoder-decoder architecture, in which you would have a first half of the network, which is just made for ingesting the whole data. And then once it is ingested, from the representation that you've learned, then you produce the data that you want to produce as output through another network that we call the decoder. And so this is exactly this architecture which is shown here, where you have a first encoder for just ingesting the sentence in the original language, and then the second part, the decoder, which is made for producing the output sentence in the target language. So in this case, it would be made of several layers, so it's a stack version of the recurrent neural network. And each of the layers is made of LSTMs, which are bidirectional. So the sentences are read from the left to the right, and also from the right to the left. There is then a special mechanism which happens in between, which we call an attention mechanism, and which we'll explain next week. But the purpose will be basically to say that this mechanism will be able to focus on only some part of the representation in order to produce the next token as output. So it's as if you knew or you learned that, okay, to produce the first word of the target's the output sequence, you only need to look at some part in the input sequence. And as you proceed further and further, you know that you can move your attention to some other part of the sentence, right? And then at each then time step, you would then produce a next token through another bunch of stacked and stacked LSTMs to then produce the output sequence. And you see that again, eventually you would find a softmax layer, which is basically modeling a distribution over all possible words in some dictionary or vocabulary, and then that you draw from or for which maybe you would just pick the largest value, the most likely value, and that would be the next token in the in the translation. So this is an animation of that same system in which first you encode the tokens. Here it's from, I suppose, Japanese or Chinese, but it looks like, I don't know, either one of them, Japanese or Chinese. And then you have the decoder, which works in steps, and at each step produce an X token, an output token. So in this case, that set of symbols is translated as knowledge is power. And you see that there is this attention mechanism, which basically allows the system to just focus on parts of the encoded version of the sentence. And finally, also, what is nice is that this system is able to produce sentences which are not necessarily of the same size as the input sentence, right? And you do that generally by having a special token which marks the end of the sentence. So that's just one more word to the vocabulary. And as soon as the system produces this token, then you end the you terminate the computation. So this was for text-to-text synthesis. You can do the same when you want to do text-to-speech synthesis. So you want to start from a sentence and then produce a waveform that would basically be the spoken version of that text, of that sentence. And again, you can do that with this some kind of encoder, decoder architecture made of several building blocks, and many of them would be recurrent neural network. So in this case, you have, for example, the bottom part of the system, which would be responsible for the ingestion of the text. So you see that we start from the original text, then there is some embedding of the character directly. They are all fed to a first convolutional neural network with three layers, which and then they are themselves the feature map that are computed are then fed as input to a bidirectional LSTM. Again, you have some kind of attention module in the middle, and then you have the upper part, which is the decoder, which would be then responsible in this case for producing this spectrogram, which is more or less the equivalent of some kind of image representation of sound, okay? And then you can use as input to what is called a vocoder, so really this some kind of synthesizer that would go from this image to really a waveform. But what is important is that that decoder would be itself defined as a composition of LSTMs, a bunch of other things, convnets, finally would produce in sequence a bunch of frames, which would then could be interpreted as this spectrogram, and then this guy could be then itself fed as input to this vocoder to produce the waveform sample. And again, even though this looks like something which is very complicated, this is just a bunch of a very large, in this case, composition of a differentiable function of small building blocks that we know how to differentiate independently. So the whole thing can be learned by stochastic gradient descent on the parameters of all these blocks. Another funny application, so this is application if you remember from last year in the introduction to AI, maybe you did not understand at the time everything from that video, but now I invite you to watch it again. And so you will remember that here, the authors basically learn how to play Mario Kart by running a recurrent neural network. And in this case, the sequence would be a sequence of frames, video frames. And at each time step, you want to produce as output. So in this case, you want to not only predict at the end, but to predict at every time step. It would predict the action. So which of the button on the joystick should you press in order to win the race, for example, or to not go out of the road.
So we'll just maybe welcome back, Seth Bling here.
Part of it.
Three of these carts are being driven by a.
We'll jump to.
Ron may remember some information that it had in the previous.
So what you see here is some part of the sequence and the different layers. And it's actually basically it's not the full frame of the general frames, but this grayscale version of the frames. And from this, they are ingested through a bunch of convolutional layers in sequence like this. And then it would run back propagation through time. So this reverse mode automatic differentiation, but on the unrolled version of the graph of computation. And at every time frame, so in this case, the author has built some data set where he has recorded himself playing, and it just wants the network to reproduce, to imitate how he would play himself the game. And so he knows the ground truths, the actions that he should predict. And then it trains the network just to reproduce that until eventually it managed to play by itself to Mario Kart. Okay, so what you see here is the agent playing itself, but the agent is nothing else than a recurrent neural network of the same kind that we've seen together. And here you see the input, then the several layers of convolutions, and finally the buttons that are pressed at every time step. This one would also be a very nice project, even though it might be a bit more challenging to make it work. It would be fun to do as well. All right, so now to conclude, I just want to say a few words about things that we now do in deep learning and that go beyond sequences. So I will start with this quote from Yann Lequin. This is something I've already mentioned, but I think now it will click. So it says that an increasingly large number of people are defining the networks, so the topology of the network themselves, procedurally in a data-dependent way, and meaning possibly with loops and conditional. That means it allows them to change dynamically as a function of the input data fed to them. And then it says, when now it comes to deep learning, it's really very much like a regular program, except that it's parameterized. So with that, what it means is that more and more we see research works in which the topology of the network is really dynamically defined from the data itself. So this is something we have seen today. The topology of the network depends, for example, on the size of the sequences, right? If you have short sequence, then the topology will be short. And if you take longer sequences, the topology will be longer, right? And this itself is defined dynamically as you run this program, in a sense, on the data that you feed to it. But this actually can be generalized to arbitrary kind of data structures as long as you can build dynamically a graph of computation. And during the computation, the creation of this graph of computation, you may have parts of the program that involve loops, conditionals, or even recursive functions if you want it, as long as you can just evaluate, the graph of computation, that means you have been able to create it, and therefore you can backpropagate through it. So by that, what I mean is that you can view computer programs, or you can extend neural nets to arbitrary computer programs, right? So the topology of a recurrent network, when it's unrolled through time, is not fixed, but it's dynamic, right? And that's really the key idea that I want you to grasp, is that the topology is dynamic. It will change from one piece of data to the next, right? And so, for example, in the case of recurrent neural networks, it depends on the input sequence and on the size of the sequence. It also depends on the graph construction algorithm that you use to consume the tokens in sequence, right? So here, today we've seen several ways, several instances of these graph construction algorithms. We've seen that we could consume the sequence forward, but also backward, or we could have several layers. We could stack these graph construction algorithms on top of one another. But at the end of the day, that would just produce a big graph of computation, right? Now, this is a principle that actually generalizes very well. It generalizes to arbitrarily structured data. So of course, sequences, but it could generalize to trees. You could run a neural network on binary trees or any kind of trees. And more generally, you could run that on graphs, right? As long as you have an algorithm that you can use to traverse the graph, right? Or some piece of code that would ingest the graph and then would do something with the nodes and the edges of this graph, right? That would define, if you could unroll this computation, that would define a graph of computation, right? So that means if the operations that you do at every step are themselves small neural networks, then you can backpropagate to everything, right? So it generalizes to structured data of any kind, and also to arbitrary graph of computation construction algorithm. So by that, I mean any algorithm that would define some way to traverse the structure, right? And here you'd be free to include any for loops, recursive calls, whatnot, that you would need to traverse this graph. So this is something you should really try to ingest and understand. I think it's really important. And if you understand that, you will understand that you can do deep learning, that you will understand that deep learning is not just ConvNet and MLP, it's really much more than that. It's really a new paradigm when it comes to computer programming. And so I will now show you a few applications of these ideas. We would need a full course actually to cover this topic properly. But unfortunately, we don't have time. So I will just show you a few applications. The first one is this algorithm that we call neural message passing, which is basically a way to define a computation over a graph. And this computation would themselves be a neural network. So the idea would be to start with a graph, which could be of any kind, right? And then to run some message passing algorithm on top of this graph. So let's say each node of the graph comes with some features, right? And maybe also the edges connecting two nodes would come with some features. Then the first step would be to basically mimic the sending of messages from some source node to some target nodes, depending on the edges that are defined in this graph. For example, we would have this F node, which would receive some message from G, I, E, and C, right? And then what would happen is that we would do this at all nodes, right? And we would do this maybe for a certain number of T of iterations, right? So now the key idea is that if the messages that you send are themselves defined as the output of some neural computation, and if what you do when you receive the message is also just defined as the output of some other neural computation, and if this is basically replicated at all nodes, then that means the whole thing is just a big, maybe weird and bizarre neural network. But at the end of the day, that means you could just unroll this computation through time as well and obtain a graph of computation. Right? So this is really this idea which is implemented here in this type of neural network. So the algorithm would be as follows. First, we would have just some embedding of the feature vectors associated to the nodes, right? So that would basically initialize some kind of recurrent state at every node, right? And then you would do some for loop, and you would be free to decide how many iterations you would want to do. So let's say we would do T of them, and then at each one of them, you would compute, each node would compute in a sense the messages it would want to send to its neighbor, right? So this would be a generic operation which would itself be implemented by another neural network, which would take as argument the adjacency matrix of the graph and the current recurrent state value of the nodes. And then the message would be, in a sense, sent to these neighbors, and they would be used to make an update to the hidden state, to the recurrent state of each one of the nodes, right? And then you would proceed like this for a certain number of T of iterations. And after that, what you would do with this representation of the nodes or the graph would be to have some kind of readout operation, which could be some kind of aggregate. Let's say your task would be then to classify the whole graph. Then you could have some kind of pooling or aggregation function that would take all the vector representation of all nodes, would produce a fixed size vector, and then from this fixed size vector would then would use that as input to a smaller classification network. And with this simple algorithm, at least, which is very intuitive to understand, I suppose, from a very high level point of view, then now you should be able to understand that this whole computation can be unrolled through time and then automatically differentiate. So that means you can learn the program, right? So even though the graph topology, and also what is important is that even though the graph topology is dynamic, so from one sample to the next, the graph will change, the unrolled computation is fully differentiable, meaning the computation, the program itself, is trainable. So this is something I've done myself in some past research work on problems from physics, but there are plenty of other applications in chemistry, in social networks, of course, and in any kind of domain where it's very natural to represent the data as a graph. And this is quite powerful because this is another way actually to introduce this kind of inductive biases that you know about the data. If you know that the data is structured as a graph, then you should make your best effort to conserve this topology as much as you can. And this would be a way to do that, to basically structure the computations according to the graph topology that you have on the data itself. This would be another example of these graph neural networks applied to object detection in point clouds. So there are, as you know, there are plenty of cameras that you can for which the output is not an image but a set of points that we call the point cloud. And similarly, as we did last week, you can actually run object detection algorithm on this kind of data. So in which you would like, for example, to find not bounding boxes but bounding boxes volumes inside this 3D representation of a scene, and that would correspond to the detection of some object in this 3D scene. And so this is an example of one such system in which you go from a point cloud representation to a graph representation, and then you have one of these graph neural network, which in this case operates as similarly to this neural message passing algorithm, that would then compute some representation, some new and higher level representation of this graph. And then finally would be used similarly as last week to produce a proposal, for example, for the bounding boxes and also for the classes that would be associated to each one of these boxes. Right? And at the end, we would have a system which would be able to tell you that, okay, I'm detecting some object at these locations, now in this 3D volume, at this and this location, and also these bigger boxes at these other locations with some classes predicted for them. A third example would be this one, which is another use of graph neural network, but now in quantum chemistry, in which the knowledge that we have about molecules and how they are organized as a composition of atoms and bondings between these atoms, and the energy that evolves or that is tied to some particular geometry or folding of the molecule. So all of this knowledge can be ingested by a big graph neural network, which would ingest basically the basic constituents of this molecule, like the atoms, and then maybe some distances between two atoms that would then define maybe some kind of bondings and so on and so on, and then aggregated together finally to produce some new representation of this data. And in this case, in this application, they are using that basically model, have a quick model of the quantum mechanical properties of of molecular systems. This is something you can do with very expensive numerical simulations, but that you can learn to basically approximate in a fast way and still being accurate with neural networks. Finally, this last example, which I think is quite mind-blowing in a sense, it's another instance of this graph neural network using this same neural message passing algorithm, but basically to learn to simulate fluid dynamics. And so the idea would be to have a graph neural network which is able to approximate a simulator, right? And the simulator would be some kind of particle system in which, for example, you would model fluids like water as a bunch of particles, and then you would model the interactions in between these particles, you're following the laws of physics. So that's something you can simulate, but that's also some numerically, but usually that's very expensive. So you would like this to be faster, but still being accurate. And so this type of simulation can be approximated by a neural network. If you just saw this bunch of, if you see that this bunch of particles is itself a graph, right? And then what is done precisely in this architecture is that you have an encoder decoder architecture, and one of the steps is based on this neural message passing algorithm. So you would run this computation for a few iterations, and you would basically learn the program to simulate correctly the dynamics that the particle should follow in order to produce something which is consistent with the actual and physically correct simulation that you started. So this is an example. So on the left, you see the ground truth. This is the expensive numerical simulation. And on the right, that's the neural network simulator. So I don't know what you think of this, but to me it looks very convincing. Maybe the physics is not, you could maybe argue that the physics is maybe not exactly correct, but at least I think it's a very good approximation of the first simulation. And what is nice here is that the laws of physics, the fluid dynamics has been in a way rediscovered by the network. Okay, it has learned that. So when you present two frames, two basically consecutive. So you start with an expensive simulation, and from this you can know some current state of the system, and then what should be the next step of the system? What should be the next position, for example, of the particles, and maybe with some other dynamical properties associated to them. And then the network will be a way to basically very quickly but very accurately predict this change in the dynamics. And when you do that, you never explicitly put any of the equations, any of the physics explicitly. It's just, it is just learned directly from the data. But also, of course, it makes use of the structure. So the fact that you model the data as a graph with some connections between the particles, some edges between particles, that's very important to make the training efficient. All right. Okay, then finally, last thing I wanted to say for today, is the last word about neural computer. So it's basically this observation, which actually not new. It's a result which has been known from 1925 already, so 25 years ago. And it basically says that, so if you remember your course from, what did you say? I don't know how you call it in English, this one. Calculability, computability, I don't know. it says that it's a result which says that any Turing machine can be simulated by a recurrent neural network. Right? And so that means any program, at least as we know today, since we know that any computer program can be implemented by a Turing machine, right, given this result, that means that any program, regardless how complicated, can actually be implemented by a recurrent neural network. So that's, I think that's a very profound and very important result, which says a lot about the capacity of this network. It means that anything that you could write in Python, C++, whatever, can be equivalently re-expressed, even though it may contain millions of lines of code, as a recurrent neural network. So of course, this is a very, I would say, academic statement. If you were trying to, for example, learn this simulator of fluid dynamics with a Turing machine, that would be very inefficient and good luck trying to do that. But still, I think it's a very important result, which says that, okay, this would be another way actually, it says still a lot about the fact that this recurrent neural network should be able, in principle, in theory, to model any programs. But again, this is still actually just a result, I think, if I'm not mistaken, about the existence. No, this one is actually the exact implementation of the Turing machine. So yes, it would work. But a Turing machine is not very something practical. So people have tried actually to get to implement recurrent neural network that would be closer and closer to what you would do in a real computer. I will finish with that. So what you see here in this slide is a network that would try to mimic the behavior of a computer in the sense that you would equip your recurrent neural network with a memory unit in which you could read and write from. So instead of just having this, for example, in the case of LSTM, this cell state, you would equip the network with a full, an entire memory, a big matrix, for example. And then you would also couple this memory to writing and reading heads that you would use then to read data from the memory and also to write data into the memory. And then you try, given this now architecture, you, for example, try to use it in order to learn programs by just observing, just from the observation of data. And so at the end, what you obtain is a differentiable neural computer that can learn, for example. So in this case, what you see is this neural computer architecture in which the task that it has to learn is to take some sequence as input, and then to reproduce that same sentence as output. So it's just a simple copy task. And so for this to work effectively, what needs to happen is that the network understands that it should read the sequence and then store it. So it has to learn how to make use of its memory unit, store the vectors one by one. And then as soon as it sees this, for example, this special symbol, also understand that now it should switch to a different mode in which now it reads the content of this memory in the same order to then produce the output value. And so this is what is done here. And you see that eventually as training progresses, it manages to solve the task of copying the sequence. So that same architecture, if you go in the paper, there are a few papers about this kind of architectures. They've also been able to learn how to sort sequences. So that's the same architecture, the training data, the input sequences would be randomly shuffled sequences, and the output would be sorted sequences. And then the network, in this case, would have to discover by itself some kind of sorting algorithm. And that's something which they managed to show as well. And when you basically dissect the operations and try to understand what's happening with a program which now has been learned from the data, you see that the network is more or less able to recover an algorithm which is similar to bubble sort, as you I suppose yourself learned before during your bachelor degree. But I think this is kind of nice and shows a lot of potential, even though this is very difficult to make it work. I think it shows a lot of potential in the things you can do with these architectures. All right, so that's it for me for today. Unless there are a few more questions.